So, Casablanca, for Casablanca, Umberto Eco says, two cliches make us laugh. I quote him, 100 cliches move us. For we sense dimly that the cliches are talking among themselves and celebrating a reunion. An intertextual archetype is a topos or standard situation that manages to be particularly appealing to a given cultural area or a historical period. Think about this, okay? An intertextual archetype is a topos or a standard situation that manages to be particularly appealing to a given cultural area or a historical period. Now, why is Casablanca appealing in the light of this quotation? Was the cultural area, was the historical period, the appeal of Casablanca? Well, you see, when the director is playing on the theme of patriotism, love triangle, okay, these are culturally shared beliefs or topos, standard situations, okay, and therefore there is a mean, and then you also have a particular historical period which is understood by most of us. Okay, so therefore, the beauty of Casablanca. Hmm? Is there anyone?
Anyway, we can relate a love triangle to World War II.
But the movie, which is a love triangle, is set during the Second World War. Okay, so we may not exactly be able to relate, but then we know that this is a story and the fate of the lovers gets influenced, impacted because of the political situation, right? Isn't that what we are told in Casablanca? But for the war, they would have been together. Okay, but it's very important that Victor Laszlo, husband, has to live on, because for the country, he is more important than Rick. Okay, and if Victor has to live on, then he has to leave that place along with his wife. Otherwise, without his wife, his work would never be, because she is, with her love, she sustains him. Okay, so it's important that she should be with him. Therefore, we need to have our hero making that sacrifice. Okay, so love is secondary, country is the most important. That's as therefore, did I answer your question? Why? How is the Second World War related to love triangle? Any questions on Casablanca? Then we can move on. So, Casablanca is referred to in another movie called Brazil by Terry Gilliam. Okay, so the bureaucrats secretly watch Casablanca and crave for action and romance in their controlled lives. So, Casablanca is evoked at some point. Although, what genre of movie is Brazil?
Science fiction,
black comedy,
dystopian.
Yeah, dystopian. You find the bureaucrats watching, the people there watching Casablanca. And again, Humphrey Bogart character, the Sam character, makes an appearance in Woody Allen's Play It Again, Sam. So, directed by Herbert Ross. So, again referring or referencing the film. Okay, intertextuality and the Western. We are going to talk about two Western texts and how intertextuality and not just a remake comes into the picture. So, there is a theme in the Western genre. A lone stranger comes into a town that has two gangs or families that are at war. Which movie we are talking about? Yes, The Good, the Bad, not really.
Remember another movie which you made us watch in the previous course? It's called Sukiyaki Western Django, which is exactly the same as this, but that's a reference
of Western Django, which Tarantino has redone. Okay, so this lone stranger wants to play both sides, okay, to make as much money as possible, but ends up in getting in trouble with both these warring gangs. Does it ring a bell? exactly. Kurosawa's Japanese film Yojimbo. So, I am talking about Kurosawa's Yojimbo and then another famous film based on the same theme, Last Man Standing, starring Bruce Willis. It's a wonderful movie, terribly entertaining. Watch it and watch it alongside Yojimbo. Okay. Clint Eastwood's A Fistful of Dollars, not The Good, The Bad, but A Fistful of Dollars again deals with the same theme. Okay. If you look at a movie like Star Wars, Star Wars theme, as we were talking about when we discussed the idea of narrative, okay, and how myths influence narratives. We talked about Joseph Campbell's The Hero with a Thousand Faces and how Star Wars follows the same trajectory. So, hero's universal spiritual journey and then hero's journey is a common theme in many films, and we have already discussed this with reference to The Terminator, Lord of the Rings and several others. You can take more examples, okay, for example, Indiana Jones, which again follows the same theme. Hero's initiation, his journey, his adventures, his temptations, a damsel in distress, a false hero, okay, and you will find. So, again we are talking about intertextuality. Even a light-hearted movie like Kung Fu Panda, you can find several quotations taken from all these films, and they are not plagiarizing. They know that we know what they are talking about. Again, the same idea of hero's journey and initiation, quest for truth, all these motifs are found in even in films like Avatar and The Silence of the Lambs, very different by way of genre, but thematically quite similar. So, now we come to the idea of cult films. Again, I quote Umberto Eco. He feels that in order to transform a work into a cult object, one must be able to break, dislocate, unhinge it so that one can remember only parts of it, irrespective of their original relationship with the whole. How many of you have watched Reservoir Dogs? Okay. Is it a cult? Okay, what's a cult? And what's a popular movie? What's a cult?
Only a dedicated following of.
Cult has a dedicated set of followers, fan following. Give me some examples. The Big Lebowski.
Dazed and Confused. Dazed and Confused.
Dazed and Confused, okay.
Pulp Fiction.
Fight Club. Fight Club, Pulp Fiction. So they are cult films. Remember, cult films are not extremely successful or very popular. What I mean is, they are extremely popular among a group of people. There are people who write about them, discuss them, etc. But they were not huge mega hits. So, Sholay is not a cult film, right? It's a universally popular movie. Again, it's if you watch Sholay, you will find several elements of intertextuality. I mean, that's a good exercise to understand. Sholay is such a popular film, okay, and if you watch it, you will find several intertextual elements occurring, existing simultaneously. So, an unhinged film should display not one central idea, but many. It should not reveal a coherent philosophy of composition. That's the idea of a cult film. Now, do you think Reservoir Dogs or Fight Club or Pulp Fiction, they subscribe to this definition? No central philosophy, but several things going on. Yes or no? Yes, that's the idea of a cult. So, cult is a term which is used very loosely often, but according to Umberto Eco, there is a definition. Okay, and cult movie should subscribe to certain parameters. So, Donnie Darko is a cult movie. Okay, you won't find a mass following for the film, but whoever has watched it, okay, they are dedicated to it. Fight Club is a cult movie. It wasn't a successful movie at all when it was released. I think Roger Ebert gave it? No. Half star. Okay. The Rocky Horror Picture Show, another good example of cult film. So, what is cult then? Again, I am borrowing from Umberto Eco's definitions. Cult movies have a world that fans and enthusiasts can explore. Everyone has a take on cult movies. Are you aware of this concept called fanfic? Okay, fanfic. Cults usually have, we are talking about fans, fanfic, fandom. So, what is fanfic? Fans start contributing to the plot, to the narrative. Okay, this is the way Harry Potter should proceed from now on onwards, and because of the proliferation of the social network media, okay, anyone can rewrite and reinterpret Harry Potter the way they want to. Okay, so that's what fans creating their own fiction. Therefore, fanfic, it's a portmanteau. So, cults borrow from other films and texts. Yes, they do. Reservoir Dogs, Brazil, they all do that. Cults have limited but very special appeal. Ask the followers and they can die for it. Some features of cult films are like they are usually strange, darko, quirky, offbeat, eccentric, surreal, with outrages, weird, unique, cartoony characters or plots and garish sets. I would say most of Quentin Tarantino movies would fall into the cult category. I mean, think Kill Bill, full of cartoonish characters, right? Cults are often considered controversial because they step outside standard narrative and technical conventions. As you were just mentioning, an anime emerges from nowhere. Okay, a Western genre comes out of the blue. Okay, so they play around with technical and genreic conventions, and of course, they are very stylized and often flawed. Some famous cult directors: John Waters, Ed Wood, on whom Tim Burton made a movie, Ed Wood, Tarantino, the Coen brothers, someone just mentioned the Big Lebowski, Jim Jarmusch. If you watch his Johnny Depp movie, Dead Men, then you will understand how cult he is and full of intertextuality. David Lynch. Any questions here so far before we go on to discuss some other films? Any comments on cult? Why is it a cult?
Extremely controversial.
Just controversy, yes, but then you have to. Yes, Aranjit.
It was controversial, yes, but it was also sort of mainstream. It was nominated for the Oscars as well that year.
Well, that does, I mean, even Pulp Fiction.
Even Pulp Fiction won.
No, but the only difference with the Clockwork Orange was it was banned in several countries because of the violence and all.
Clockwork Orange wasn't.
You know what happens when films get banned.
It is the content.
Look at our recent example. So, it's always good publicity. No? Even if you are not interested in that film initially. Yeah, so banning of films is not such a bad idea after all. Okay, even if it's banned initially, it's always good publicity. So that doesn't. So carry on. Yes, you were saying.
Yeah, I lost track of what I was saying.
Okay, so Ridley Scott's Blade Runner, 1982, starring a very young Harrison Ford. is another example of intertextual text based on Philip K. Dick's very eccentrically titled novel, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? The book makes a reference to Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. We have already seen that, what it was all about. Blade Runner is often seen as a postmodern classic. We will soon be doing modernism in cinema and postmodernism in cinema. And why is Blade Runner a very good example of postmodernism? So it quotes, alludes to, and references to other texts, and also the way it represents spatiality and temporality. What's the space of Blade Runner? Yeah, where is it set?
Future world.
In the future. Okay, so and what's the time? Again, we are not very clear. Somewhere in the future. The opening sequence begins with a close up of an anonymous eye. We don't know whose eye it is. And it has references to Dante's Inferno, Divine Comedy. And there are three parts to Dante's Inferno, Divine Comedy, and one part is Inferno. So you know, all these images of fire and destruction in that eye, all these are reflected in the eye. So eye is a recurrent motif in the film. You also have a character of the eye maker, someone who makes eyes. Have you watched the movie? Yeah, good. Eyes are seen as a window to the soul, and then an eye watching over you throughout them. You know, the big brother is watching you, that kind of a sense. It was not an instant commercial success. Most cults are not. They are not instantly commercially successful. But it has a faithful group of and very loyal group of followers. How many of you actually like Blade Runner? Okay, you like, okay, good. Again, people have read images of LA as a city, although it's not very clearly mentioned which city it's set in, but then people were, by the way, by the look of the imaginary town, we are told that this could be possibly LA. And then it's set in 2019. At some point, we are told that the period is 2019, and therefore Blade Runner had a very strong influence on subsequent futuristic films, Matrix, for example. There is a constant image of a very weird kind of a city in Blade Runner, and full of what? Advertisements, commercials, okay, people, you know, all these hyperlinked stories telling you what to eat, what to think, what to wear, okay. So you are talking about a society where you are surrounded with commercialism, okay. The city, extremely dystopic, unclear, unstable. And we'll be discussing the Blade Runner soon. I want you to watch it. We have a long weekend. So watch the movie, and on Monday we will be continuing the discussion of the film, okay, as an intertextual text. So three aspects of Blade Runner that you should be talking about or thinking of. One is the city speak, the language in the city. Okay, there is a thing called city speak. The kind of language the characters speak. The Tyrell Corporation, what does it stand for? And then what's the meaning of the replicant? You know what are replicants in the movie, but watch it all over again and you will understand. So the original screenwriter, although based on someone else's work, but Hampton Fancher was the screenwriter who said Blade Runner was always meant to be cautionary. For instance, the film was shot during the period of President Reagan, and the cruel politics portrayed in the film were my rebuttal of Reaganism in a sense. So, does that remind you that films need to be, or intertextual films, when we talk about intertextuality, we are also talking about the socio-political, cultural aspects of a particular period. Okay, so again that takes us back to the original contention that films are not created in a vacuum. Okay, even a movie like Blade Runner, based on someone else's work, but when it's adapted for the screen, the screenwriter has some kind of a context. Okay, there he has some kind of a vision, and what kind of socio-economic, political, historical context he wants to situate the film in. So, therefore, intertextuality. If you know the Reagan period, and if you know the excesses of the Reagan period, you will be able to relate in a better way to the film. That's the idea. If you don't know anything about it, then much will be lost on you. Okay, so we will meet again on Monday, having watched Blade Runner. Thank you.